Today we will do chapter 4 as much as we can. Okay. And conceptually nothing much new. It is energy analysis of closed systems. Now you know what closed system is. And we went through the energy analysis, the energy balance. So what we will do is apply the energy balance to closed systems. And probably you remember what closed system is, right? It is a system that doesn't involve any mass transfer. So we have a system here, okay? We can have a heat entering, work entering or leaving, but we cannot have any mass entering or leaving, no mass, okay? In the next chapter, Chapter 5, we will deal with those. We will deal with our control volumes. So what are the objectives in this chapter? We will go through the moving boundary work, okay? Which is also called PDV work, okay? And then we will review the first law of thermodynamics, which is the conservation of energy. We will go through again the general energy balance as applied to closed systems here. And we go through some examples using water refrigerant. And then we will switch to ideal gases, okay? And define a specific heat in general, and then specific heats for the case of ideal gases. How to calculate internal energy changes, enthalpy changes, and do some examples. And finally, we will go through incompressible substances and do energy balances there. Incompressible simply means systems involving solids and liquids. Okay, they are called incompressible because the specific volume remains almost constant. So this is what we will do in this chapter. So basically, moving boundary work, energy balance for closed systems, general specific heats, internal energy enthalpy specific heats of ideal gases, and then solids and liquids. Okay, let's start with moving boundary work. Okay. Now, consider a piston cylinder device, as you see here, right here. Okay. And we have a gas here. Now, obviously, this boundary here cannot move. There is a, you know, rigid surface there. But this boundary right here can move because the piston is free to move. It can go up and down. So this is the moving boundary, whereas the other part is a fixed boundary. And here we have a pressure. And if, let's say, this boundary moves, that means pressure, let's say the area here is A, times area, which is the force, acting through a distance, okay, which is work. Now, the question is, how do we deal with this work? Now, first of all, this is a very practical problem because in practice, we use it a lot, okay? Now let me see if I can show you a video here. Just to show you the car engines, how the piston and cylinders work there. Okay, that's enough. So you see what the piston cylinder device is and how it is used in practice there. And
Sure.
here, let's say you see the actual car engine. Yeah.
We didn't see video.
Yeah, you didn't see the video?
Yeah.
Huh, strange. let me. I'll send it to you. Okay, then you can watch it
yourself. Actually, sir, if you want, first stop the share, then share again, then it will be work. It will be work.
Okay, let's try it. Let me see. Okay, here. Okay, share content. Okay, do you see the video now?
So if first stop sharing. Stop sharing. Yeah.
Okay, let's do that again.
Okay.
Let's see.
Yes. Now share again. Yes.
Okay. Okay, is it working?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, that much is enough. Okay. Now, can you see the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let's make it bigger. So basically, car engines. You have seen a cylinder, but in an actual car engine, you have several cylinders. In this case, we have two cylinders here. Okay, and most cars they have four cylinders. Some, of course, have 8 or 12, whatever. So these are the two cylinders, and here is the crankshaft. Okay. Now, how do we analyze it thermodynamically? Okay. Now, let's assume the piston, this piston here, moves a distance ds. Okay. So it goes, up here, a distance ds. Now, what is the force acting on the face of piston? Now we have the pressure p. Okay. The pressure is force per unit area. Right. So what is the force acting right here? That force, it is the pressure times the area. Okay. Now ds is a small distance, a differential amount. Therefore, if you multiply the force by the differential displacement, okay, you will get the differential work, DWD, boundary work. But force is pressure times area, okay? And area times, this area times ds is displaced volume, dv, okay? This one here, like this. Therefore, dwb, differential work is pdv. Then, if let's say you go from 1 to 2, okay, then work will be integral pdv, okay, from 1 to 2. And this is the formula or relation for moving boundary work, okay? And this is the reason that it is also called pdv work. It is a pressure times the change in volume. So instead of force times the displacement, we are saying force is pressure times area, and area times displacement is volume change. So it is a pdv. So the derivation is very simple there. Okay, now if we plot this on a PV diagram, let's say the piston is initially here, right here, the piston, okay? So state one, and this is the pressure P1 here, okay? And the gas is expanding, doing work, okay? Until we reach point two. So at the end, the piston is right here, okay? Now the question is, what is the work done? Now we know it is P times dv, okay? Integral from 1 to 2. This is the work done. And what is a pdv? Okay, this is dv, right here, this distance here, okay? And this is the value of the p. So this height multiplied by this width here is pdv. So w is integration of this differential area right here, okay, which is that. But if let's say you are finding the area of the curve, you would do the same thing. What is the area of the curve, under the curve? It is a differential area, okay, integrated from 1 to 2, and the dA is simply pdv. Therefore, the area under the process curve on a PV diagram is equal to the boundary work. Okay? So this is the geometrical representation. If you have a PV diagram, okay, and plot the process curve, assuming it is a quasi-equilibrium, that is, equilibrium conditions are almost maintained inside, and if you plot the process curve like this, okay, the area under the process path will give you the boundary work done. Okay, any questions so far? No questions. So very clear. Now, since work is the area under the process curve, and let's say this is the initial state, this is the final state, there are many ways to do this expansion. The process curve can be like this, can be like that, can be like this, right? And the area under the curve, let's say curve C, will be different for different cases, which means the work done between two states, states one and two, will be different for different curves depending on the path followed, okay? Therefore, this is initial state, that is the final state. What is the work done? We cannot determine that. We have to know what the process path is, because the area depends the curve followed here. It is a path function. In the case of a cycle, okay, let's say you have a compression process like this, and then you continue and then have an expansion process like this, and you return to the initial state. This is a cycle. If you follow different paths during compression and during compression expansion, the net area, okay, is the net work done. Okay. This is the net work done. And this is what happens in car engines. We have the compression. Okay, you compress the air and then you burn fuel and you increase the pressure. And then you have expansion at high pressure. So the average pressure is higher. And at the end, you still have the atmospheric pressure when you take in fresh air there. So this is the network done in car engines. Now, keep in mind that when we have a piston cylinder device like this, let's say we are compressing, the compression work depends on the pressure right here on the inner surface of the piston. During quasi-equilibrium process, it is the same pressure everywhere in the case of gases. But if, let's say, you have non-quasi-equilibrium process, then we simply use the pressure on the inner face of the piston, which may be easy to determine, to measure by using pressure transducers there. Okay, also keep in mind that, let's say, we are doing boundary work. We are doing boundary work. What happens to that work? Let's say this is the gas, and the gas is expanding, and the piston is moving down. Now, first of all, there is atmosphere here, so you are pushing the atmospheric air out. That means you are doing work against the atmosphere. What else? You have friction here, okay, between the piston and the cylinder. So you have the friction work to overcome that friction, which is converted to work. And this may go at the end to the crankshaft here to rotate it. So you have the shaft work. Therefore, the boundary work done is the sum of the friction work, the work done against the atmosphere, and the power transmitted, the work transmitted through the crank to maybe the wheels or whatever load you have. Okay. Therefore, it can be expressed this way. Keep in mind that anytime you produce work, the conservation energy requires that you should be able to trace it as to what you did with that work. Okay. So that is the theory. Now let's go through some examples. Let's say we have a rigid tank. If you have a rigid tank, what happens to volume? Anybody? The volume remains?
Same.
Yeah, same, constant. So we read the problems carefully. We have a rigid tank. It contains air and ideal gas at a given pressure and temperature. And there is a heat loss to the atmosphere, to the surroundings. And the pressure and inside in the tank drop to these values as a result of heat loss. Now the question is, what is the boundary work done during this process? Okay, now what is the boundary work done? Okay, let's use the formula. Boundary work is from state 1 to state 2 integral PdV. Okay, what is dV during this process? Do we have any change in volume? No. dV is zero, therefore automatically the boundary work done is zero. Okay, now let's do a different way. Let's plot this process on a PV diagram, pressure volume. Let's say this is the initial state right here. The volume remains constant. That means the process curve will have to take place on this line, right? Constant volume line. Because if you have a constant volume process, this is the V right here, okay? It has to be vertical like this. And as you go vertically down from 1 2. Okay. Now what is the area under this curve, under this line? Zero, right? No area. So area is zero. Again, the boundary work done is zero. Which means if you have a constant volume system, the pressure, temperature inside may change. But since there is no boundary moving during that process, the boundary work will be zero. Okay. And another case that the boundary work will be zero is, look at that P, if you have absolute vacuum, absolutely zero vacuum there, okay? Zero pressure. If the pressure is zero, again, the boundary work will be zero, meaning you cannot do work or transfer energy as work against vacuum because you are not compressing anything, you are not transferring any energy there. Okay, let's take another special case. This time, we have a frictionless piston cylinder device. Okay, it contains steam, mass is given at a certain pressure and temperature. Now, heat is transferred inside until the temperature reaches 250 degrees. The piston is not attached to a shaft, and its mass is constant. What is the work done by the steam during this process? Okay. Now the problem says here there is no shaft. Okay, right here. So there is no resistance, or the work is not transferred anywhere. And here there is no friction. Okay. That means the pressure inside will have to remain constant. Why? As you add heat, this will tend to expand, right? But the pressure inside is balanced by the weight of the piston and by the atmospheric pressure, which is P atmosphere times the piston area. And during the process, they are not changing. Atmospheric pressure is constant, the area is constant, the weight of the piston is constant, okay, which is mg here, which means since the piston is not accelerating, it may be moving there, the net force there must be zero, which means the pressure inside must remain constant, okay? And on a PV diagram, if you plot this, again, a constant pressure curve on a PV diagram will have to be a horizontal line. P is constant. Because anywhere in this line, if let's say this is P, for example, X, the pressure anywhere on this line is PX, constant. Okay, in our case, it is 400 kilopascal. And this is the starting volume, that is the ending volume, let's say. So the process curve will have to be like this, a horizontal line segment between states 1 and 2. Okay. And what is the work done? Obviously, it is the area, which is a rectangle. Okay. And what is the area here? The horizontal length is delta V. The vertical length is P0 there. So it is the pressure times the change in volume. P0 is the constant pressure there. That means P0 is 400 kilopascal constant, delta V. It means if you can find the initial and final volumes and get the difference, then you can get the work done. Or you can do the integration. Boundary work is integral P dV, but P is constant, which is equal to P0. Since P is constant, we can take it out of integration. And the constant value is P0 here. So P0 integral dV. And what is integral dV? V, right? From 1 to 2, V2 minus V1, which is the area there. This is total volume. But total volume is mass times specific volume. Okay, If you replace V by MV and factor out M, you get mass times, pressure times, the change in specific volume. Now that means if you can determine the specific volumes at the beginning and at the end, then you can just plug those in and you can get the work done. In this case, the steam turns out to be superheated vapor, okay? And if you read, let's say P1 is 400 kilopascal. And what is T1? 200 degrees. And if you go to steam table and read V1 from there, so it is 400 kilopascal and 200 degrees, you will read this value. And final state, 400 kilopascal and 250 degrees this time. If you read V, you will read this value. Plug those in. Okay. We get this. The kilograms will cancel. And we have kilopascal cubic meter, which is kilojoule. Okay, so what is the result? 122 kilojoules. This is the amount of work done by the steam as it expands at constant pressure and temperature rises from 200 to 250. Okay? Any questions on these two examples? No questions? Okay, so clear. Okay, now let's do another special case. What if instead of volume or pressure, we have an ideal gas and the temperature remains constant? If the temperature remains constant, we call it isothermal, right? So isothermal compression or expansion of a gas, obviously we are compressing in this case. Okay, we have a piston cylinder device, initially at a given volume and pressure and temperature, okay? It is now compressed to this volume, so a quarter of the initial volume, such that the temperature inside the cylinder remains constant. So T is constant. Question, what is the work done? Okay. Now, look at the conditions, atmospheric pressure, room temperature or something. So we can say that air at the specified conditions can be assumed to be an ideal gas. It's a very fair assumption there. Okay. And we can use the ideal gas equation, which is PV MRT, but T is constant. So T1 is equal to T2, which we will call T0. For constant things, we like to use the zero subscript here. Okay. So for ideal gases, this is what we have. PV MR T0. Okay. T0 is constant. R gas constant is constant. The amount of mass inside, this is a closed system, so mass is constant. Therefore, you have three constants. Their product is also constant, and we call it C. And if you solve for P from there, then P becomes equal to a constant divided by volume. The volume is obviously variable. Okay. Then I can just use the equation. What is boundary work? Integral PdV. And what is P? P is C over V, dV. C is constant, so I can take it out. C is out here. Then we have integral dV over V. And what is integral dV over V from high school? Logarithm, natural logarithm V, right? From 1 to 2, natural logarithm V2 minus natural logarithm V1 or natural logarithm V2 over V1. Okay. But C is equal to MRT 0, okay, which is PV at any state, which means P1 V1 or P2 V2. I can take any of these. I take P1 V1 since I know those. So in place of C, I use P1 V1. Of course, I can also use MRT 0, okay? P1 V1 log V2 V1. Okay. Then if I can plug in the values, because I know pressure 1 V1 and I can find, let's say, V2 is given. I don't need that. So P1 V1 V2, those are what I need. So if I plug in these values, right, I can calculate. Okay, so this is you can see it what in more detail here. Do I not have the result? It looks like I cut it short, but anyway, if you plug in the values here, okay, you will get the result. Okay. Another special kind of process, it is called a polytropic process. Usually in practice, whether you have a compressor or car engine, instead of volume, pressure, or temperature remaining constant, PV remaining constant, usually we have a process curve, which can be expressed like this. PV to some exponent is equal to constant. And N is usually a value between 1 and 2. Okay? That exponent that. Therefore, P1 V1 to the N is equal to P2 V2 to the N. Or, if you solve for P from here, it will be C times V over minus N, as you see here. And how can you find the work? In this case, again, boundary work is PdV integral, okay? P is minus CV, CV to minus N. So we plug it in here. When you integrate, remember again from high school, integral, let's say, y to the n is y to the n plus 1 over n plus 1, right? So it is what we have. And if it is from 1 to 2, okay, this is y2 to n plus 1 minus y1 to n plus 1. You get this. But these are also equal to you can show that P2 V2 minus P1 V1, 1 minus N, which is also MR T2 minus T1 using the ideal gas equation over 1 minus N. Okay. So by doing this integral and knowing that PV to the N is a constant, okay. You can show that during the integration, the boundary work in this case is for a polytropic process of exponent n like this, MR delta T divided by 1 minus n. Okay. Any questions here? Okay. Just a simple integration there. Of course, in our problem, you may be given any relation. P is equal to some function of V, okay? Then you should be able, by doing the integration, to determine the work. For example, in this case, work will be integral from 1 to 2, that function of V, dV, right? So if this is given, you can perform the integration and get a relation for the boundary work. Okay, expansion of a gas against a spring. Now let's have a system like this. Okay, let's make it a little more exciting. We have a gas. It is not specified. The initial volume is given. Initial pressure is given. And initially, a linear spring. Linear spring means F is a constant times displacement, X. Okay. With a spring constant K, which is 150 kilonewton per meter, is touching but exerting no force. So zero force at this point. Okay, so initially 200 kilopascal, initial volume is 0.05, so initial point is right here. Okay, the spring is touching. And we are heating the gas here until the volume doubles. So initial volume was 0.05. That means final volume is 0.1. Okay. If the cross-sectional area of the piston, the area here is given, 0.25 square meters, as you see here, what is the final pressure? What is the total work done by the gas? And what is the part of this work done against the spring to compress it? That is how much of that work energy is stored in that linear spring. Okay. Now the easy way to solve this problem, first of all, linear spring means on a PV diagram, it will cause the pressure to increase linearly like this. Okay, so this is the P2 to whatever value this corresponds. Okay, and the work done is this total area. So you don't need to do any integration, just the entire area. And if there were no spring, process curve would be like this, right? If no spring. Now, because of spring, we have this extra area. Therefore, this extra area should correspond to the work done against the spring. And how can you find this area? It is the area of the triangle, right? So this is delta V, we know that. And if you know the final pressure, you know the two sides of a triangle, you can calculate the area there. Now, so numerically, final volume is, it said the volume doubled, so 2V1, so it is this. And the displacement of the piston, delta V over A, delta V is this, and the piston area is that. So this is how much the piston compresses the spring, okay? And spring force is given by this relation, Kx. We know the X, the spring constant K is given. So plug those in. This is the force at the end, okay? The spring force. The pressure is force divided by area. Okay. The force is 30 kilonewton and area is given. So you get 120. Now this is the pressure increase due to spring. Initial pressure was 200. Now we have 120. So if you add them up, you get the final pressure. And if you know the final pressure, the total area is, you find the area of this, the total area, right there, which is this, okay? And to get the spring work, you get this area of the triangle, which is this one here, okay? Therefore, the end result, the total work done by the gas is 13 kilojoule, and 3 kilojoule of it is used to compress the spring. Another way to find the spring work is just use this formula. Okay, remember from the previous chapter, 1 over 2 k, the final length square minus initial length square, it will also give you the spring work, which is again the same result here. Okay? Any questions on this example? Okay, no question. Let me go through the energy balance and then take a break because there is nothing new, just a review. Okay, in the previous chapter, remember, the first law is expressed as energy in minus energy out is equal to energy change, okay, for any system. Energy in, energy out mechanism, it can be by heat, by work, by mass. In this chapter, we don't have mass, okay, only by heat and work. And energy changes, the internal for simple compressible systems, kinetic potential energies, we will not deal with the other ones, or in the rate form, rate of change, I mean, rate of energy entering and leaving is the rate of change of the energy of the system, okay? So this over dot right here indicates rate. On a unit mass basis per kilogram, you can write it this way. Energy in minus energy out per unit mass is energy change per unit mass of the system. In differential form, you can write it this way, same thing, okay? And for a cycle, special case, in the case of a cycle, the energy change of the system is zero. Therefore, net heat transfer is equal to net work transfer. Okay. And you can also write it in the rate form. Q dot net is equal to W dot net. Okay. So this is the cycle and this is the network. So if you have like a car engine, if you model it as a closed system, I think a better model is a Stirling engine, which we will see in Thermo 2. Okay. Then the net heat transfer is must be equal to net work transfer. Okay. Because the system simply is undergoing a cycle. So the net energy change within the system is zero during steady operation there. You can also write it this way. Okay, when necessary. Let's say Q net in minus W net out is change in energy of the system. Okay, and net heat is Q in minus Q out, and net work is work out minus work in. Usually, if let's say we don't know the direction, we assume heat is entering and work is leaving. Okay, and then if you get something negative, you simply reverse the direction there. Okay, and let me go through this example. Before the example, let's stop here, take a 5-minute break, okay, and then we will continue in the next hour. And also, if you have any questions, I will go through your questions first. So I will see you in 5 minutes. So let's take a short break.